Hello, I'm Doug Muzzio. This is the second in a series of City Talk discussions with the candidates in the 2009 New York City elections. Mike Bloomberg lose the November mayoral election? Forget about it. Beat the $15 billion gorilla? Impossible. Not so, says Comptroller William Thompson, and he's here to tell us why and how he intends to pull off one of the great upsets in New York City political history. Welcome back, Mr. Comptroller.
Doug, good seeing you.
Two questions. What are you inhaling, ingesting, or injecting? And secondly, are you a masochist?
The answer is no and no.
Okay. Let's go on. How do you beat Mike Bloomberg? How does Mike Bloomberg lose the election? It seems to me it's Mike Bloomberg's to lose. How does he lose it? How do you win it?
Well, it's not Mike Bloomberg's to lose. No. I think that, number one, look, New Yorkers are tired of Mike Bloomberg. It has been 8 years of Mike Bloomberg, 8 years of a top-down approach, 8 years of Mike Bloomberg telling New York City what's good for them. I think that if you look, it is everything that he's done, particularly during these tough financial times, it shows he's not there for the average New Yorker. Water rates that just went up 13% after going up double digits for the last 2 years. Tax hikes. I see they're about to increase the sales tax another 0.5%. That falls on the backs of working New Yorkers and middle-class New Yorkers. Property taxes, which went back up again this year. It is everything that Mike Bloomberg has done that shows he's not there for the average New Yorker. He's not there for middle-class New Yorkers and working New Yorkers. And I'm getting that message out. I think people understand that in their hearts. Not even to talk about the term limit change, where he ignored the voters.
Okay, we'll
all
talk
of
about
those
that.
Things together. He's going to be able to get a message out to people about Mike Bloomberg and tell them the truth. That's how he loses.
Wait a second. If you look at the poll numbers, and obviously there are weaknesses in poll numbers, there's snapshots at a time, we'll use sample, etc. But the bottom line is that Mike Bloomberg's got fairly high approvals. According to one poll, the approvals are moving up about 60%. With all of this, and then when you ask them, does term limits matter, they say no. Does this matter, they say no. Does his wealth matter, they say no.
Doug,
where is your hope?
The one thing right now in the hope, just what you said right there, his approval rating moving up again. But then again, when you ask people, are they going to vote for Mike Bloomberg, the number's down. He just spent he's probably closer to $30 million right now. After he'd spent $20 million, he was at 47% as far as in a re-election. He spent $20 million, he was still at 47%. His numbers didn't budge. It's almost as if he's spending money to try and convince New Yorkers that he's somebody different than he was for 8 years. Guess what? New Yorkers aren't buying it. There are lots of
Wait a minute. Who is this Mike Bloomberg that you see them creating in their ads?
The Mike Bloomberg, the five-borough economic plan, the Mike Bloomberg who's there for small business, the Mike Bloomberg who understands your pain, the Mike Bloomberg who isn't just a Manhattan-centric mayor. That's who they're trying to convince you that he is. And the truth is, there has been no focus in this city on small business for 8 years. Mike Bloomberg doesn't understand anybody's pain. He's this person who said, geez, at $400,000, the president isn't making any money. He's the person, you know, who continues to say, we don't want to tax the rich and increase taxes on the rich. And in fact, he's pushing taxes on our back. So the Mike Bloomberg that they're trying to convince you, the person that he is the casual Mike Bloomberg walking around the city of New York, stopping in the corner deli and listening to problems. That's not the Mike Bloomberg that New Yorkers know. So they're spending, in the end, probably $100 million to try and convince New Yorkers that Mike Bloomberg is somebody different than the person he has been for 8 years.
But wait a minute. New Yorkers elected Rudy Giuliani twice and nearly the first time. And Rudy was not really a very pleasant person. I think we can agree upon that. So the fact that they may not like the mayor and may not like some of his attitudes and orientations, do they have to like him to vote for him?
It's not a question of liking him. New Yorkers
Okay, you're right. Okay.
I didn't say like. Right. It's a question of, is he there for them? Does he understand the people that he represents? I don't think so. New Yorkers don't think so. So.
Well, okay. Mayor Thompson, tell me how you better understand the people in the Bronx or Staten Island or Queens, and that you could make their life substantially better than Mike Bloomberg could if you're a mayor.
Doug, I am the person in Brooklyn or Queens or the Bronx or Staten Island or big pieces of Manhattan. I am that person. I'm a middle-class New Yorker who understands the ups and downs, who understands having, you know, make do from perhaps one check to the next, who understands that, you know, something, the fiscal situation that we're in right now creates real strains on families all across the city of New York. I'm the person who went to public schools in New York City, who didn't who doesn't have to worry about where am I going to be jetting this weekend. I'm the person who understands the hopes and dreams and aspirations of New Yorkers and understands that it's harder and harder to live in this city each and every day. The mayor talks about, geez, we don't want to tax wealthy New Yorkers because they may move out of New York City. What about the rest of us? Taxes, water rates, sales tax, property taxes are going up on us. Where do we go? What happens to middle class and working New Yorkers? Where are we going to go? We almost can't afford to move some other place, so we just have to stand here and get squeezed, and it becomes harder and harder to live in New York City each and every day.
Okay, that's your message. All campaigns need what I call moms. They need money, organization, message, and strategy. So your message is Mike Bloomberg isn't like you. He's, you know, he's a Manhattan plutocrat who doesn't feel your pain and doesn't want to, and acts in the special interest of the elite. That's your analysis.
I think he's been the Wall Street corporate mayor for the last 8 years, and I think everybody else understands that.
So in
that.
A sense, you've got this sort of populist campaign, the revolt. I mean, we've lived through this in a sense before, the revolt of the outer boroughs, you know, congestion pricing, tunnels,
tolls on the bridges,
So in a sense, it's Manhattan Mike Bloomberg against, you know, Williamsburg William Thompson.
I'm not going to say Manhattan Mike Bloomberg, but I think the mayor, who represents a very few people in this city, and it represents more than anything the wealthy, you know, the wealthy New York, as opposed to everybody else. And I think that's not my message. I think that's his message. So, you know, it is merely in looking what he's talked about and pointing to it.
Okay. You've got a message. The question is, how do you get it out? Which gets us to the first M, and that's money. The guy's got, we know, 100, 120, whatever it takes. With the campaign finance match, mm-hmm. how much money do you expect to be able to spend during this campaign through the general election?
Hope to be able to spend somewhere between $10 and $15 million.
So at the minimum, he's going to outspend you 5, 6, 7 to 1.
Okay.
Now, how do you get your message out? Assuming that your message, in a sense, could resonate with voters and perhaps get you elected, how do you overcome the air war that he can put together?
By beating him in the ground war. That's exactly what you have to do. You have to build. We just looked last November. You just witnessed the greatest grassroots effort that this country probably has ever seen as we elected Barack Obama.
Right.
You have to put people together. You're not going to beat him on the air. You've got to beat him on the ground.
Can William Thompson and his campaign put together the Barack Obama, you know, model? Can he do it?
I think that it is possible. I think that New Yorkers, so many of whom got involved last year to bring change to this country, want to see a different New York City.
Yeah, but wait a second.
Wait a second about what?
Wait a minute. Mike Bloomberg ain't Dick Cheney and George Bush. I mean, you had some real characters that you could really get worked up and hate in that last election.
Mike Bloomberg is the person who, after telling New Yorkers for 7 years that he would never change term limits by going to the city council, in fact, did that. And by his own comments, he termed that anyone who would try and do that, it would be disgraceful. That's Mike Bloomberg's comment. I think New Yorkers would like to come together. I think middle class and working New Yorkers understand they're being squeezed more and more each and every day and would like to see a different direction in the city. Would like to have somebody in City Hall who's going to stand up and fight for them. So I believe that you can put New Yorkers together, not necessarily into the same level of Barack Obama, but you know something? In a huge way, in a huge grassroots effort, to be able to come together, to reach out to the neighbors and friends, to be able to put together a strong campaign in a neighborhood to neighborhood to neighborhood basis.
But then we get to the organizational and the technical question. Can you put together, can the William Thompson campaign put that together since Bloomberg's hired the people who did all the micro-targeting for the national campaigns? Do you have the...
Yes.
The ability to do that?
Yes. And we've already put together a good campaign staff. You talk about people who did micro-targeting. Well, guess what? The people who did the website, the people who did the tech piece for Barack Obama are working for me. Others are working on my behalf. Mm-hmm. But it's not just a question of the technicians who put it together. It's a question of the people of the city of New York. And when they want to make change, when they want to see something different, and I believe that they do, they'll come together. I'm not worried about that. So we're reaching out to people across the city, organizing across the city on a grassroots basis. That will help to build. And no, we'll have enough money to get a message out in TV and radio. You don't need to be able to compete dollar for dollar. You need to be able to get the message out. I'll have enough money to get a message out.
Okay. Now... let's go. So we talked about message. We talked about money. What about organization? You're really, in fact, just really right now, within the last couple of weeks, putting together a campaign team, a full-fledged campaign team.
I still think we're adding to it, but we've had a campaign team together for, for the last couple of months. We're adding to it on a weekly basis, and we're going to continue to do that.
And it seems also, I mean, just watching it, that the campaign is beginning to generate some energy, because for a long time, it wasn't where's Waldo, it's where's the controller?
Mike Bloomberg has spent at least $20 million to create a distorted sense of reality, spending money in April and May on TV and radio to convince you and other people, particularly in the press, that this campaign is over.
Okay.
This campaign is just starting.
Okay, so here comes...
So he spent more money earlier than ever before to try and let you get you to believe, and others, that the campaign's over. It is just starting. It is June. You know something? This election's in November. It's not in July. It's in November. The campaign will be there. And no, as you point out, it is gearing up. It is rolling things out. It is moving forward and bringing more people on board. So I'm not worried. Mike Bloomberg has spent money to convince you and others in the press that this election is, that this is a July election. It's a November election.
But he's also, between his private largesse and his public expenditures, mm-hmm. either bought or neutralized potential critics and opponents. I mean, you've got labor unions, business groups, liberals and conservatives.
Which labor union?
Black and white.
How many labor unions have supported him? I think it's one or two. So wait a minute. He's convinced, and you just pointed out, labor unions. There haven't been that many labor endorsements of Mike
Bloomberg. That's certainly true, but we're early.
Is
he able to buy more?
You're right. It is early. You just made that point. It's early. You don't think there are going to be a number of unions to support me and my candidacy? Okay. So what's then how is Mike Bloomberg have the high road there? How is Mike Bloomberg the guy who all of a sudden he's got all the unions? He doesn't.
No, I didn't say he has all the unions, but once he's bought pieces of what might be called a traditional Democratic coalition.
What pieces has he bought?
Well, I mean, some of the cultural critics, own them and they're going to be quiet. Some of the civic groups, they're shying away from him.
That's not who, in fact, those aren't the people who move New York City.
Don't start me with the newspapers then, because
the
then,
one thing that you...
Okay. Go ahead.
People drive this. It isn't the critics in different places. It's not the civics. It's people who drive this. We forget that. You go back and look at the lessons again. Look at the lessons from last year. People drove that election. 3 years ago, if I would have said to you Barack Obama was going to be the president of the United States, you would have said, now, you're an informed guy, so you would have known who I was talking about. Most Americans would have gone, who? Who?
And I would have said, no!
Exactly. You would have told me,
oh, no.
What are you ingesting? or have you lost your mind?
Right. Well, wait a minute. I mean, we all know that the impossible happens in politics. Mark Green recently said that there were no locks. And Mark Green, of all people, should know, since Mike Bloomberg had no chance to win in 2001.
Mike
and neither
Bloomberg
did Baruch.
Had no chance to win in 2001. In 2008, Barack Obama had no chance to become the president of the United States. In the late 90s, Chuck Schumer was at 3% in the polls, and he's the United States senator right now. So to question...
You can go back to Ed Koch being 3%
exactly.
in the
so
polls.
We can continue to run down the list of people who weren't supposed to be there, and I'll let you add me to that list next year.
Okay. So the basic, you see the basic Bloomberg approach as, in a sense, calling the election off, saying that this is a no-win game. So you get headlines like, you can't stop Mayor, or, you know, there was a spate, there had been a spate of articles saying, you know, Thompson can't win, you know, the mayor has to be caught with, you know, in really compromising situations with pictures.
And now what you're seeing, is some articles where people take a step back and go, wait a minute. Let's take a look at this. Errol Lewis in the Daily News says, wait a second, this election's not over, this election's just starting. Starts to look below the surface at, since everybody loves to quote approval ratings, he started to look at the polls, as others are starting to do, as they're starting to get out of offices and talk to people across the city of New York in different neighborhoods who are going, I'm tired of seeing these ads, and I know he's not there for me. Or, it's nice to see these ads, but wait a minute, it is. I was at a city council hearing yesterday. The council members pointed out, geez, he's talking about 400,000 jobs across the city of New York. His own administration, his own Office of Management and Budget, is saying over a two-year period of time, the city is going to lose 300,000 jobs. Wait a minute, how does that match up? They didn't just ask me. They asked the Independent Budget Office and others. So I think that across the city of New York, now there's a hesitation as we're moving in gear, as we're in on my timetable, not my Bloomberg's timetable, my timetable, where people are starting to say, wait a minute. What really is going on here? Is there going to be an election? Yeah, we think there is. Is it going to be contested? Yes, it is. It is getting out and talking to people around the city of New York who are tired.
How do you break through the sort of the media gate? It's there. I mean, I've been on in campaigns, and sometimes you wonder, what does it take for me to get in the paper? And it seems to be you must be experiencing some of that, you know, if it's not written in the paper, it hasn't happened yet.
Well, some of it is just, you know, continuing to push things each and every day. You know, you look at something earlier, you know, this week, we're out in front of Jamaica Hospital. And you've had hospitals closing in Queens.
Right, emergency hospital. And I've been to both of those hospitals.
You know, Parkway's closed, Mary Immaculate's closed, St. John's
is closed.
And all of a sudden, Jamaica Hospital, given the outbreak of the H1N1 virus, you know, the swine flu, all of a sudden the emergency room goes from 300 to 330 a day, which is a busy day. Last week, 667 people showed up.
And you warned about this. You did a report, what, in 2006?
2006, where we talked about it, when St. John's and Mary Immaculate closed, reached out to the fire commissioner because he's in charge of EMS. You also said to the state of New York.
And they didn't do it.
At all. And now what we're seeing is, you know, emergency rooms that are inundated. They've got trailers out in front of the hospital dealing with the situation, and they need help, and so do the other hospitals in the area. Well, we go out. There's lots of TV there, as well as radio. Today, you know, or the day after, you look at the press, it doesn't get covered. Is it a story? Absolutely. But I think it is continuing each and every day to get out there to point out where New York City needs to have change. And eventually, you know something, it will sink in.
So we're going to see you doing five borough campaigning all hours of the day and night. You're going to pull a Chuck Schumer and
see,
do it all the
time? See, the thing about it right now, I'm already doing five borough campaigning all around the city of New York. If you notice, New York One is starting to cover it. Others are starting to pick up. So, no, New York One shows up on the weekend and says, wow, wait a second. Thompson started out first in, last Saturday. Started out in Washington Heights.
So you got
a huge group of Latino supporters. Now you move over to Brooklyn.
So we're gonna see highly active, you know, energized Bill Thompson out
there. It's already been there. The press is starting to cover it now. And I think that's the press needs to focus that this campaign is starting.
What evokes the best responses? How do you resonate with the audience, or how does the audience resonate with you? What's the gut that makes it?
It's talking to people about the issues that face them. It is talking about, you know, affordability in New York City. It's talking about housing and how they're all being pushed out of their neighborhoods because people can't afford to live here. You'd like to be able to you know, bring your family up in New York City. You'd like to be able, if your children want to stay here, you'd like to be able to see
them. How does a Mayor Thompson facilitate that?
Oh, I think you talk about the need for more affordable housing, and affordable now being low, moderate, middle-income housing.
Where do we get the money?
You know something. Back in the late 50s and 60s, as I pointed out, when you had a housing crisis, you did a Mitchell Lama program. You wound up creating tens of thousands of housing units across the city and somewhere in some places across the state. Guess what? We need focus like that in New York City. It is talking about housing. It is talking about education. And while the trumpeting of, you know, scores, I think that people feel that, wait a minute, this is just about standardized testing.
Talk more about the schools, because it seems to me, and even from your statements, that if there are Achilles heels, one of them would be the school system, whether it's mayoral control or actual performance, this overcrowding.
I support mayoral control, but I think that there need to be some changes there. I think there need to be opportunities for parents to really be involved.
How would you change it?
Well, we've talked about the need. There are vehicles that are in place, whether they're community district councils, whether they're local leadership teams in schools, that are being ignored. We need to make sure that they are not ignored. We need to give parents, and you're going to close a school in a district? Parents should be aware of it.
Okay,
they
and
be involved
you did,
in that
and your office did a report called Powerless Parents, how New York City Department of Education blocks parent influence in local school governance. In addition to the your argument, you know, the lack of outreach and discussion
even,
with parents.
It's not even outreach. It's turning their backs. School system is turning its
back.
So
you're saying it's active.
Absolutely.
And it's active and intentional.
Parents across the city of New York are frustrated. And one thing the report points out, in some of the districts across the city, parents just walked away. They got involved in 2004.
How do you mobilize them into an electoral constituency? I mean, you're running for office. How do you mobilize the parents who are ticked off about kindergarten or having their kids freezing in the winter?
Parents,
how do you do it?
There are parents who are reaching out to us to get involved because they're tired of being ignored. We're tired of this top-down approach from the Tweed courthouse, you know, a chancellor and a mayor who don't listen to parents. And if you look, the mayor a few weeks ago had said, look, parents shouldn't be involved in educational policy. We don't want to hear from them here. Wait a minute. You want parents involved. If you have more parents involved, it is better for your school system. It winds up you have better students. It's parents are reaching out to us. Are we reaching out to them? Absolutely. But people know, and parents know, we've been out there working for them. I've been out there talking about the need to involve parents on a greater level, not just now, but over the last 7 years.
How do you change this structurally? I mean, it's going to be before the legislature. What is your recommendation for? You're going to be mayor.
Made a number.
Lay it out.
I've testified twice before the assembly committee making recommendations.
You know what? I missed a reading.
Hey,
you know.
Well,
I'm going to send this to you. I don't know.
But my experience as president of the Board of Education, no legislators are listening. So when you talk about the need for an independent testing authority that oversees scores and
like
standardized
IBL.
Tests, that also oversees graduation rates, dropout rates, so we have some
independent database
for a change, that talks about the need for in the school system, you know, a budgeting structure and spending that starts to become transparent so they can't hide money any longer as they've been doing. But also a school system, I've always talked about the need for, you know, smaller classes in a number of different ways, focus on literacy. Focus on making sure that arts and music education stay in the public school system. All those things are disappearing. Put a map in front of our children these days. Ask them to identify a place in the world. They can't. There's a lot of test prep.
So there are real curricular problems given the No Child Left Behind.
Structural and curricular. So I think there's just this, you know, George Bush, No Child Left Behind mentality that permeates the New York City public school system needs to change. We need better rounded students.
But from a political perspective, how do you take this anxiety or anger and meld it into a viable political force that will unseat, will produce this upset?
It isn't one issue. It is a multiple. And
Let's talk about in the time that's remaining, the matrix of issues that you see as a winning platform.
Here, let me throw five issues out quickly that have happened over a period of time. Term limits, that's a piece of an issue. It's not the main issue. It's a part. I think tolls on the bridges, as the mayor looked to close, you know, the MTA budget gap, his recommendation, tolls on the free bridges, impacts on Brooklyn, Queens, Upper Manhattan, the rest of the city. I think sales tax increase that they're talking about right now, another half a cent, as well as getting rid of deductibility on clothing. You know something? That impacts middle-class families and working families.
What do you do instead?
I've talked about increasing taxes on those making $500,000 a year or more. They're not going to move. I know, because that's where you're going to come
back. No, not necessarily that. No, I've made the argument that the data doesn't show that. But if you've got a high income tax at the state level and a high income tax at the city level, it has to have some negative impact.
Sunset it. I think everybody realizes we're going through tough times. Let that continue for 3 years and then sunset it and mean it. So you know something, the one thing, keep your promise, keep your commitment, sunset that, let it, you know, and 3 years later, let that disappear. Those are just a few things. The education system and parents feeling shut out. A mayor who doesn't listen to the people in his city, who doesn't understand the goals, you know, the struggles that they go through on a daily basis. Four or five things that you start to put together. That's just the beginning. There are issues that come up every day. The water rates that, again, 3 years in a row, 11.5%, 14.5%, and this year, 13%. We've shown that people are being overcharged. Issue after issue after issue.
Let's in the last minute, let's go through the numbers. I mean, we all play this game. What percentage of what recognizable voting blocks? I mean, I don't understand how you win this.
Look, number one, New York City is 5-1 at least Democrat to Republican registration. That's a beginning and trying to bring.
But it didn't do Ruth any good.
No, but you know something?
Go ahead.
It is June. It's the beginning of June, and I can say that I'm going to be the Democratic nominee. Nobody's been able to do that this early and start to unify the Democratic Party across the city of New York. That's occurring now. If you notice, last week, all the candidates for comptroller in the city, at least, were running
Democrats. At that press conference.
They came out and endorsed Latino elected officials, who, as a matter of fact, from the Dominican American community, on board. You continue to do that. You continue to unify the Democratic Party, one endorsement, one group at a time. We continue to build on top of things. And then I think, look, I'll have appeal to neighborhoods across the city of New York, African American, Latino, ethnic communities all across the city of New York, each and every borough. I'm not, you know, this isn't a let's break the percentages down. I think that there are people in this city, I think the majority of the people in the city would like to see somebody different, would like to see someone in City Hall who's going to stand up and fight for them, and that person is going to be me.
And
you were speechless?
Right, yeah, I
you
know.
You were speechless?
I know. And I'm sorry. I apologize.
You were speechless for a change. That's different.
I don't know. I couldn't come back. And besides that, we were running out of time. Thank you. Hello, I'm Doug Muzzio. Let us know what you think about this show. You can reach us at CUNY.TV. When you get there, click on the bar that says Contact Us and send your email. Whatever it is. Thanks, no thanks, obnoxious, do it. Send it.